hallelujah to the house of the Lord this morning. Anybody can say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Where are you this morning? I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let's look to the Father. Father, before we ask you for anything, we come to say thank you this morning. Thank you for life and health and strength. I thank you for the activity of our lives. God, it's because of you that we live. It's because of you that we breathe. It's because of you that we have our being. And this morning, God, your sons and your daughters come to say thank you, thank you, thank you. We say thank you for loving us. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for healing us. You are good, God, and you deserve an awesome praise, God. You deserve an incredible praise, God. And now, Father, we ask that you would come on in this room and have your way. Now we ask that you would come on in this room and have your way. We say, King of glory, fall in this house. Father, we lift up Apostle King now as he prepares to teach the word. We thank you for your words are going to go forward with power and demonstration. Father, we need you. We ask that you would move in this room this morning. Father, we ask that you would speak in this room this morning. Somebody needs you. Somebody needs a change. Somebody needs a breakthrough. And now, God, we ask that you would have your way. Father, I declare an open heaven here. I declare an open heaven here. We thank you for miracles, signs, and wonders. We declare that they shall be our portion. Father, I thank you for breakthrough that's going to fall in this room this morning. I thank you for those visitors that are walking in one way, God, but they're living as family. This morning, God, we ask that you breathe in this house. Breathe in this house. Would you breathe? Would you breathe? Let's go. Would you breathe in this house? King of glory, have your way. King of glory, have your way. King of glory, have your way. Fall in the room this morning. We welcome you here, King. We welcome you here, Father. We welcome you here, Holy One. Would you fall in the room? Endow us with power this morning. Somebody needs breakthrough this morning. Somebody needs healing this morning. Somebody needs salvation and deliverance this morning. We have to do a send your word, God, and break up everything that's not like you. We have to do a send your word and heal this morning in the name of Jesus. As we posture ourselves to receive your word, we come saying yes this morning. We say yes this morning. I declare miracles here. I declare miracles, signs, and wonders, and it shall not be otherwise. Fall in this room, God. Holy Spirit, break out here. King of glory, break out here. Father, have your way. Let the fire of God fall in this house and burn up everything that's not like you. Burn up everything that's in your way. We lift you and we love you. We love you and we lift you. Fall in the room. Fall in the room. Would you breathe on us? Would you speak to us? Would you heal us? We yield ourselves to your spirit this morning. We give the right of way to you, King. And we say, have your way this morning. Whatever it is that you want to do, whatever you want to say, however you want to say it, we say yes to your will this morning. We command our soul to bless you this morning. Father, look on the service. You know what we need before we even ask, God. And now, God, we come knocking, knowing that you are the door. We come knocking this morning, asking that you would do it, knowing that you're able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that already worketh in us. So we ask, oh God, that you would do your will, that you would move here, that you would speak here, that you would heal here. We thank you for your word. Let your word fall here. Let your word go forth and fall on good ground. Let your word go forth and fall on good ground. Heal us this morning by your word. Wash us this morning in your word. Wash us this morning in your word. We declare that we will never be the same again because of your presence. We will never be the same again because of your word. Whatever it is, we come to jump in the river this morning. We come to jump in the river this morning. The river of healing, the river of breakthrough, the river of deliverance. We come jumping in the river. Have your way is our prayer. Have your way. Have your way. Speak to us this morning, King of glory. King of power, King of our joy, have your way. We say yes. We say yes. We say yes to you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We say yes to your move. We say yes to your way. We say yes. Anybody brought their yes this morning? We say yes to you. We say yes to your move. Let there be a breakout. Let there be a breakout. Holy Spirit, break out in this room. Fall on us this morning. Endow us with power. Somebody this morning, we say yes to your will. Yes to for your will. Yes to your way this morning, and it shall not be otherwise. Yes to your word. Yes to your instruction. Yes to your direction. We thank you for what you're saying, how you're going to do it, how you're going to move in the name of Jesus. It shall not be otherwise. We don't wait to see it, but we tell you thank you. We don't wait to see it, but we give you glory. Let God's people clap your hands, shout hallelujah, and amen to the glory of God. Is there anybody that really come to bless him? Don't let your praise drop. Let's worship our King.
Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. We make a choice to rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, stand on your feet, everybody in the room. Hallelujah, as we begin to open up with praise and worship, could you do me a favor? Find two people that you didn't ride with, hug them and tell them, welcome to service this morning. Come on, let's go. Come on, welcome them. Come on, hug them real good. Now put your hands on it and help me praise and celebrate Jesus. Come on, clap your hands all over this room. Come on. Yep, that's it. We come to worship here. Oh, yeah. I will sing praises unto my King, yeah.
I will sing praises unto my King. Yeah.
He is creator of everything.
He is creator of everything.
I will exalt him, his name adore, yeah.
I will exalt him, his name adore, yeah.
Honor and reverence forevermore.
Honor and reverence forevermore.
We lift to our God,
to our God.
To me we ascribe. That's it. To our God, say.
To our God.
Come on, clap your hands all over the room as we worship the one true and living King. Come on. This praise I will offer to glorify thee.
Praise I will offer to glorify you.
And I'll declare that thy name is holy.
And I'll declare that thy name is holy.
Be thou exalted above the heaven.
Be thou exalted above the heaven.
And all thy glory above. Let's go. We lift.
We lift
up our
to our God.
To our God.
To our God.
To
our God.
To me we ascribe.
We
ascribe.
We ascribe.
We lift up our heads.
We lift up our
heads. To our God.
To our God.
We worship,
we worship,
adore you,
adore you.
We declare,
we declare.
Nobody like you,
nobody like
us.
We worship,
adore you,
adore you.
We declare,
nobody
like you,
nobody like
us. Let's go.
We worship,
adore you,
adore you.
We declare,
nobody like you.
We
worship,
adore you,
adore you.
We declare. Nobody like
you.
We worship.
We worship.
We give you glory.
Adore you.
We come to declare.
We declare.
Nobody like
you. Nobody
like
you.
We worship.
We worship.
Adore
you.
We declare.
We declare.
Nobody like you. We worship.
We worship.
Adore you.
Adore you.
We
declare.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
We worship.
We worship.
We adore you.
We declare
nobody
like you.
Say nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Say nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Do you know it in the room? Say nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Many have tried, all have failed. Nobody.
Nobody like you.
Yeah. Say nobody like you.
Nobody
you. Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
No one before you.
No one beside you.
No one beside you.
No one behind you.
No one behind you.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Say we declare.
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 Your glory.
We declare.
Your power.
We declare.
Be in the room.
We declare.
We declare.
Put your hands.
Let me see you clap those hands.
Let me see you clap those hands.
Let me see you clap those hands.
Say, let me see.
Let me see you clap those hands.
Let me see.
Let me see you clap those hands.
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 Nobody like you.
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 Say we declare.
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 Cause we send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
Every tribe.
Gloria.
Every nation.
Gloria.
Every tongue.
Gloria.
Every creed.
Gloria.
We send up. We send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
We send up. Say
nobody like you.
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 Cause we send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
We send up.
Gloria.
From the north side.
Gloria.
To the south side.
Gloria.
From the east side.
Gloria.
To the west side.
Gloria.
Say you get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
Say it's yours.
It's yours.
It's yours.
It's yours.
It's the end.
We send up
glory.
We send up
glory.
We send up
glory.
Send it, send it, send it.
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 Glory.
Say you get the glory.
You get the glory.
Say you get the glory.
You get the glory.
Say you get the glory.
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 Say we declare.
We declare.
We declare.
We declare.
Yeah, yeah.
We declare.
Yeah, yeah.
We declare.
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 Power.
Power.
Somebody, somebody, somebody call me Jesus.
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 Bring it down. Now everybody clap your hands. Come on. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I got an answer. So for whatever you need, I got the answer for you this morning. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
That's the answer. Say Jesus,
Jesus,
that's the answer.
Jesus,
Jesus, that's the answer.
Jesus,
Jesus. Say nobody like you,
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 nobody, nobody,
nobody, nobody, nobody like you,
nobody like you,
nobody like you. Say we declare.
We declare.
We declare.
We declare.
The power of God.
We declare. God. The power of God. The power of God. The power of God. The power of God. The glory of God. The glory of God. Say nobody like it.
Nobody like it.
One more time, can we do it? Sing, nobody like
you. Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Let them sing it. Y'all better sing. Tell your trouble. Tell your enemy. Tell your sickness. Tell your struggle. Say nobody like you.
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 Nobody like
say there's only one God.
There's only one God.
There's only one God.
There's only one God.
See, there's only one God.
There's only one God.
There's only one God. Nobody like him. The offspring of David. The lily of the valley. The burning morning star.
There's
only one God. And we call him Jesus.
Jesus.
Some call it. Come on, call him. Demons tremble. Bodies are healed. Lives are changed. When you call
Jesus,
when you call
Jesus,
the atmosphere changes.
Jesus,
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 Jesus.
Now open your mouth right here and shout. Shout the name of Jesus. Shout the name of Jesus. Shout the name of Jesus. He's the remedy to your issue. He's the remedy to your problem. He's the source of all your strength. Somebody shout Jesus. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the next time you get in trouble, I dare you to shout Jesus. I mean, the very next time you go to the doctors and they give you a bad report, I dare you to look at the doctor and say, Jesus! When they're doing a layoff at your job, you can receive the pink slip or not, but I want you to know that the name of Jesus can turn any situation around. Shout, Jesus! Jesus!
Jesus!
What's his name? What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
What's his name?
Jesus.
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 What are you calling?
Jesus.
Somebody lift him.
Jesus.
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 Something about that name. 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 Jesus.
Jesus.
Mind regulator. Heart fixer. Scripture redeemer. My kids be redeemed. Somebody call him.
Jesus.
Now shout if you love him. At the mention of his name. We got a mover. Somebody shout, Jesus. The more you call him, the better you'll feel. Somebody call him Jesus. If that's all we do for the remainder of my time, just go crazy and call his name. That's why we came here. We need you, Jesus. We need you, Jesus. We decree and we declare power. Jesus, 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 Jesus.
to the next key. Don't worry about the track. Lift your hands all over the room. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, we're just going to sing the one line. Ready? Say, when I think of the goodness of Jesus. That's it. Lift your hands and all he's done. Take me out right here. For me. Say, I can't stop praising his name.
I can't stop praising his name.
Everybody lift it up in the room, yeah. Say, I can't stop praising his name.
I can't stop praising his name.
Yeah. Hey, I can't stop praising his name.
I can't stop praising his name.
Say, never let a rock cry out for me.
Never let a rock cry out.
Never let a rock cry out for me.
Say, never let a rock cry out for me.
Cry out for me.
Cry out.
Cry out for me. I won't let a rock
cry out.
I won't let my neighbor. I won't let a tree
cry out for me.
Cry out for me.
Cry out for me.
Cry out. See everything to me,
everything.
Life and bread,
life and bread.
Ooh, everything to me,
everything.
Joy and sorrow,
joy and sorrow.
I can't stop praising His name.
I can't stop praising His name.
Hope for tomorrow. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, I really do know, he holds the future. Oh yes, he does. And life is worth the living just because he lives. Now it's your turn. Say, because
he lives.
Yeah.
I can face tomorrow.
Say, because he lives.
Because he lives.
All fear is gone.
All fear is gone.
Because I know.
Because I know.
Praise him. Everybody praise him.
Praise him.
We call to praise him.
Praise him.
Ooh, we praise him.
Praise him.
We like to call him.
Jesus.
Somebody help me call him.
Jesus.
He's both the lion and the lamb. Jesus.
Jesus.
Everything I need. Mountain mover, my healer,
Jesus.
The lifter up of my head,
Jesus.
Somebody, somebody call it.
Jesus.
We gotta go now. Help me call it.
Jesus.
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 Jesus. Cadillac.
Jesus.
Great defender.
Jesus.
Chief physician.
Jesus.
Cornerstone. A wheel in the middle of a wheel. Call it. Call it. Call it. Call him. Somebody call him. Jesus.
I dare to call the name of Jesus. I dare to lift up that name. Demons tremble at the name of Jesus. There is no other name under heaven. preaching. Call his name. You feel better every time you call him. What's his name?
Yeah.
Sounds like somebody loves Jesus in this room. It sounds like somebody loves him. It's all right to shout unto God. I feel better every time I call him. I feel better every time I call the name of Jesus. There's no other name like the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Well, good morning, Connect Church Plano. Unapologetically known as Connect Church Global. Listen, it is our honor and our privilege to welcome you here to one of the greatest churches in this region, Connect Church Plano. For those of you who do not know us, my name is Desiree.
And I'm Jerome.
And like I said, it's our honor and our privilege to welcome you here. We know that some of you came here as guests, but we are believing by the time you leave here today, you'll be leaving as family. So welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. We do have a few announcements as to what's going on here at Connect Church Plano. We will not be before you long, starting with Wednesday nights. Jerome, what happens on a Wednesday?
Listen, I would love to invite you out on Wednesdays. Many are not having Bible study on Wednesdays, but I would love for you to join our community. Where are you all that say, I want to join the community. I want to jump in on a Wednesday. I want to join. I want to be a part of the Wednesday night. I'm a part of the community. And why don't you be a guest and join our community and meet us at 7:15 every Wednesday for Bible study. I'm telling you, we are inspired on Sundays, but we are truly growing on Wednesdays. Where are the Wednesday night people? Where are those that are coming? I mean, it goes forth on a Wednesday. Apostles have been teaching under the power and the anointing of God. So would you be our guest and join our community? Choose community this Wednesday at 7:15. Also, now there. Another thing that's not happening a lot, but we have Sunday school here. You don't hear about that a lot at other services, at other churches, but we want to remind you that there is no Sunday school next week due to Easter, but we will resume that the following week. So prepare your minds for that as well. So we would love for you to be our guest.
And speaking of Easter, next weekend is Easter weekend, y'all. And here at Connect Church Plano, it is a huge deal. We call that our Super Bowl Sunday, so we've entitled it Easter Bowl Sunday. And listen, we are believing God for 600 faces to walk through those doors through the course of 3 experiences. I don't know if y'all heard that number, 600. 600 faces.
It's going to happen, too.
100 souls saved.
Already done.
All through the course of 3 services.
It's already done.
So like I said, you have 3 experiences you could choose from. We have 8:30, we have 10:30, and we have 12:30. I'll say that again, 8:30 for my early folk, my 10:30 for those who want to get out of church on time and go enjoy an Easter lunch, and my 12:30 for everybody else. Listen, we want you to choose an experience to come in and get a word, and also choose an experience to volunteer in. Here at Connect Church Plano, listen, we get in where we fit in, and we want you to join the mission with us. If you believe in our vision of this church and the vision of 600 people walking through those doors, absolutely, make sure you get in the app and sign up to volunteer. We have so many ministries you could be a part of, so make sure you fill out that form and get in the know. And speaking of the app, make sure you download the app. Download the app. Download the app. It is so easy to find Connect Church Global. Get in there, join the community, create a profile, and get in the know. Do not miss out on what's going on here at Connect Church Plano. And we are going to continue to move on in worship. Pastor Billy.
Can we praise the Lord, everybody? Hallelujah. Well, if you're new to the ministry, you probably don't know a lot, but the Lord has been growing this ministry for the last few months. Can we give God praise? As you can tell, if you look around, second service is already packed out. That's why we're moving to 3 of those services. But the good thing about God growing and expanding this ministry, God is sending so many different gifts to our church. Can we celebrate the gifts of God that God is sending here? Hallelujah. One of those gifts is the gift of ministry through dance. Amen. And so today I have the esteemed privilege and honor of introducing for the first time at Connect Church our dance ministry. Amen. Yeah, that sounds better. Can we give God praise for them? But biblically, if you go back to scripture, even in Exodus, one of the first times dance is mentioned in Exodus 5 when God brings the children of Israel out of captivity over the Red Sea. It was Miriam, Aaron's sister, who brings out her tambourine and she leads them in dance to celebrate and rejoice about what God has done. If you move on to 2 Samuel, you'll find that when David receives the Ark of the Covenant back into his possession, he gets real undignified, and the Bible declares that he danced before the Lord. He danced so good that he came out of his priestly garments. I want you to look and say to your neighbor, say, neighbor, it's all right to dance.
But I am honored to introduce, for the first time in ministry here at Connect Church Global, our dance ministry, Christopher, Chaz, and Sequoia. Can you give God praise for them?
Break you to position you, break you to promote you, and break you to put you in your right place. But when he breaks you, he doesn't hurt you. He doesn't, when he breaks you, he doesn't destroy you. He does it with grace. Ah! Anybody been gracefully broken where? Ooh! Thank you, Lord. Thank you. So, Father, tonight we're broken before you. Thank you for handling us with grace. Your worship right there in this moment. All I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire. Set me on fire. Come on, say. Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire.
Ask him, say.
Set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully
I'm not afraid.
I'm right here, pouring out my life gracefully.
Wow, let's give the Lord some praise. Amen. Wow, what a powerful man. And can we thank God, amen, for our liturgical team doing a tremendous job. Come on, put your hands together for them. Wow, what a powerful, powerful moment. We're excited about what God is doing in this church and just to see the growth and just things that we get a chance to experience in church ministry is encouraging. Amen. Do me a favor. I want you to stand to your feet. I want you to leave your seat. I want you to find someone. Tell them it's good to see them this morning. Come on, love on them. This is how we do it at Connect Church. Tell them it's so good to see them this morning. It's good to see them. This morning. Praise God. It's good to see them. Good to see them this morning. Praise God. Listen, let's stand. We're getting ready to receive the word of the Lord. After this, it'll be completely voluntary. We're thankful. We want to encourage you. Everybody holler, next Sunday is the big day. Come on, say it again. Next Sunday is the big day. Come on, yes, yes, it's the big day. So we want you to come and bring your family with you as we celebrate Resurrection Sunday. We want you to bring, if we can get everybody to bring one. Look at you to say, everybody, bring one. It's buy one, get one free Sunday, all right? So you buy one, you bring one, all right? But we have three experiences. Let's thank God for everyone who's going to be serving in those three experiences. It's going to be tremendous. This week, we're going to be praying. We're going to be fasting. I'm going to ask you, I didn't get a chance to mention this in the first service, but this week, I'm going to ask you guys to join us. It is Holy Week as we celebrate the Passover period. It is a time where Jesus is taking his journey into Jerusalem. And so this is a time where, honestly, we should be pausing and reflecting. This should be a time where we're being very introspective concerning what we are. As Paul says, let every man examine himself. And so this is a great opportunity to do that. So I'm asking you this week to join us as we fast this week till 12 noon. Nothing till 12 noon. But I want you to be praying for the souls that we believe are coming on next weekend. We aren't just interested in filling the house. We're interested in at least 100 people giving their life to Jesus. That's what it's really all about. And so the Bible says that the harvest is ripe, but the laborers, they are few. And so now that the laborers have stepped up, we're excited. I think we're right at 70 or so volunteers for Easter Sunday. Can we give God praise for that? And so if you want to serve, we still need your help. Parking lot ministry, kids ministry. The students are going to have their own lively experience, puppets, and it's going to be a great time for them. We've spared no expense for Easter Sunday because for us it is a big deal. It's the why behind the what. So we want to encourage you. Game trucks for the younger. Some of you grown folks probably will be on the game truck, but so game truck, it's going to be a great day. Just about to say it's going to be a great day. So do us a favor. If you're not serving, we want you to get involved in serving on that particular Sunday. We need your help. 600 people in faith will walk through the doors of this church. At least 100 of them will give their life to Jesus on one day. Amen. So we thank God for that. All right. I don't know where Pastor D went, but knowing her, she's around here shouting somewhere, probably getting her private praise on in the bathroom. Can we thank God for her? Amen. Pastor D. Amen. Bless God for her.
Let's go ahead and go into the word of the Lord. We're going to be over in 2 Corinthians, chapter number 10. We have been in this conversation on breaking bad, dealing with habits, mind games is what we'll talk about a little bit today. But specifically over the last couple of weeks, we've kind of dealt with your relationships with people. And so today we're going to deal with another crucial area where the enemy is kind of working against the body of Christ. But on today, somebody shout, today I'm going to get delivered. Amen. Say that one more time. Today I'm going to get delivered. All right. So we see here in 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, verses 1 through 6. In it, you find these words. I, Paul, myself, entreat you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. I who am humble when face to face with you, but bold toward you when I am away. I beg of you that when I am present, I may not show boldness with such confidence as I count on showing against some who suspect us of walking according to the flesh. He says, for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ, being ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. I want to look at verse 3 will be the focus of our time today. For though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war against the flesh. This morning, for our time together, I want to deal with this conversation entitled Habitual Mind Games. Habitual Mind Games. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, we're going to help you with your mind today. Habitual Mind Games. Father, yeah, look at y'all shifting now. I tell you, boy, he's already working. There she is. So I done got caught up now. I saw you walking in. Like, who is that? Oh, that's my wife. Amen. Put your hands together. Amen. Come on. Let's walk down this aisle. I tell you. Vanessa, what was I getting ready to say? I was getting ready to pray. Father. That's 18 years of marriage right there, all right? Father, bless this word in Jesus' name. Amen. Take your seat. All right. If we're going to have a conversation about the mind, first thing we need to understand, one is the anatomy of man. The anatomy of man. You need to know, first and foremost, who you are, what you're made of, because once you distinguish the difference in those areas, and we can properly appropriate what God desires from our lives and what he wants to do through our life. And so what I want to first do is kind of give you, have somewhat a few minutes about the anatomy of man. And the first thing I want to do is talk to you first off about your body. Somebody shout, I got a body. Come on, say it again, I got a body. Some of us more than others, but we all have a body. I have a body. I'm praying that by the end of this service, God's going to unbig my body. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we have a body. Everybody shout, we have a body. The body is your earth suit. The body is your earth suit. Everybody shout, my body is my earth suit. Come on, say it again. My body, little, medium, big, or large. It's my earth suit. It is what it is. It is what it is. My body is my earth suit. Okay. Now, with your earth suit, you need to understand that your earth suit is used as a vehicle for either sin or holiness. Yes, sir. It can be used for for sin or holiness. Everybody say it again. My body is my earth suit. I need this, you understand, because you get to determine what you do with your body. You get to determine what you do with your body. All of us in this room got here one way or another. Either we doored or Ubered here, lifted here, drove a car we own here, whatever the case may be. But it took a vehicle to get us here. Would you agree? A vehicle brought us here. There's nothing wrong with the vehicle that brought you here. The issue is the person in the seat could use that vehicle against its intended purpose. So by nature, the vehicle isn't bad. The problem is the person who has the keys to the vehicle. The wrong person with the keys can use a vehicle for vehicular manslaughter. You can't get mad at the car. It's not the car. The car is only doing what the car was called to do, and that's run. Does that make sense? So it's going to be extremely important that you understand the issue is not with your body. Oh, Lord, help me teach this thing. I'm trying to help free somebody. The issue is not with your body. Because I want you to understand that even God doesn't have an issue with your body. As a matter of fact, Scripture says your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Why would God dwell in something he has issues with? So your body is your earth suit. It is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Somebody shout, my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Now the question is, we got to have a conversation concerning the person who's housing the body. Does this make sense? Because through your body, the glory of God can be revealed. Glory of God can be experienced through your body. It is through the body that we interact with the natural realm. The natural realm, everything that God created, everything that God made, everything that was made by God. So we get a chance to experience in the natural realm the things that God has created. When God created earth, he looked back at earth and said, everything is cool. What it is. He looked at the grass. It's cool. He looked at night and day. It's cool. He looked at everything around him and he gave it a green check. It's cool. Verified. Then he decided to make people who would experience what he created in the natural. And that's how you and I came on the scene. Does this make sense? All right. So it is through the body that we interact with the natural realm. It's where we see. It's where we hear. It's where we get physical touch. It's where we get a chance to experience people and things in which God has made. The body is important. The body itself isn't inherently sinful. It can carry the glory of God. Number two, you not only have a body, but you got a soul. Somebody shout, I got a soul. Soul food, a soul. Soul, you have a soul. Sounds good right about now. Soul food, a soul. The soul is the seat of your emotions. Okay? The seat of your emotions. This is important. The seat of your emotions, the seat of your emotions, your mind, which is your imagination, your will, which is your desires, and your emotions, which is your feelings. The soul is a decision-making center. The soul is a decision-making center. So now we're getting a chance to understand why your body keep being in places you shouldn't be, because the decision center is not together. Okay, so I gotta kind of help you understand that you busy working on your body when you need to be working on your soul. This is why Scripture says, not work out your own body's salvation. It says work out your own soul's salvation with both fear and trembling. God is not concerned about your body because he knows the body is an instrument. It is a vehicle. So the issue is not the vehicle, it's the soul that houses that vehicle. Is this making sense today? We're going somewhere. It is the decision-making center where your personality resides. The soul acts as the battleground where your choices are made, bridging the physical body, look at this, and your spiritual essence. So I need you to see this, that your body has two influencers. is going to be your soul. And then thirdly is going to be your spirit. Your spirit. Everybody shout, my spirit. Say, I have a spirit. Okay, I have a spirit. Your spirit is the deepest, is your deepest connection to God. Spirit is your connection to God. It is the core of your identity and the place with fellowship with Him. It is through the Spirit that we worship God. The Bible says, for God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must what? Worship Him in what? Not in body or in soul, but worship Him in what? Spirit and in truth. The Bible says, I have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has in store for him, for us, but it is by his spirit that those things are revealed. So your ability to do whatever God wants you to do through your body is going to come through the spirit. Am I helping you today? Now, depending upon who you give most of your time to will determine where your vehicle lands. I'm trying to help. Just because you got gas don't mean you're headed in the right direction. Gas is just designed to get you to where you put in the navigator of where you want to go. So I'm trying to help you understand that if you are going to break bad habits and break the bad habits that are necessary for you to grow spiritually, we're going to have a conversation about the area of your life where your decisions reside. Where your decisions reside, your decision resides. Okay, got it. Just made that up. It is through the Spirit that we truly know ourselves, and we are also known by God. The Holy Spirit residing within the Spirit comprehends God's wills, secrets, desires, and fully guiding us into alignment with Him. Now, this is important because I think some of us get in trouble when it comes to living for God, is because you think you live to connect with God. I'm going to say it again. You think you live to connect with God, when in reality, you're not to live to connect with God. You live from connection with God. Oh, Lord, help me today. This is important. You live from connection with Him. You're not looking to connect with Him. You're already connected because you got His Spirit. He says, when you get saved, I'm going to give you a new heart and I'm going to give you a new spirit. As a matter of fact, Jesus says, when I ascend, He says, I'm not going to leave you comfortless, but I'm going to give you my Holy Spirit. My Holy Spirit is going to lead and guide you in all truth. And so when you live in your body, your objective, anytime you come into a room, we ought to experience a connection that you have from God. But the problem is the saints are busy trying to connect with Him when He's already in you. He's already in you. This is where He says, wherever you are, I am. This is why you got to be careful with where you're taken. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying to you today? So if there's enough believers who've been connected to the Spirit and we're doing what we're supposed to do, there could be a move of God in this service right now. You know, somebody can get delivered in this service right now. Somebody can get healed in this service right now. Somebody, oh, y'all ain't talking back to me. Cancer could back up in this service right now. Depression can back up right now on your roll if we got enough people who are engaged with the Spirit. But you can't engage with the Spirit as long as you allow the enemy to harass your mind. Because you letting the enemy work overtime in your mind, and you're going to recognize that a lot of decisions you are attempting to make, you're making them from a broken mind. Is this helping somebody today? Let me prove this thought here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, "He says, I now may the God of peace make you holy in every way. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless." Which means that if you let God lead you the way God wants to lead you, He says, I'll run your life. God says, I'll run your life in a way that people will be amazed at the results that you deliver. But if you don't let me lead you, you're going to be inconsistent in what you produce. You're going to be inconsistent in what you deliver. We don't know what we're going to get. You're double-minded. Is this helping somebody today? So as we begin to delve more into this conversation on habitual mind habits, what I'm trying to get somebody to understand this morning is you're going to have to make a decision to file an eviction in your mind, which means you're going to have to evict old thinking to experience the right side of living. You're going to have to evict old thinking. The Bible says, be not conformed to what? This world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. That is your soulless realm. Your mind operates in your soulless realm. So you're going to have to do some work in the soul so that your body can align properly to what God wants to do in and through your life. So somebody shout, I got to experience the right side of living. Now, let me just be candidly honest with you, and I know I'm going to get in trouble when I say this. I'm no sports expert. Don't know a whole lot about sports. If you invite me over to the house and we have chicken wings, I'm just going to be as clueless as a three-year-old watching the game with you because I don't know what's going on. I know when somebody has a touchdown. I know when somebody hits a three or a two or whatever the case may be, that's about all I know. Okay, I just know enough to act like I know what's going on, but not enough. I don't know who won the Super Bowl. I don't know. I don't know who was in. I don't know what the score was. I don't know any of that. I look at your name. He don't know. Don't know. Don't ask Pastor about the stats. Don't ask him what you think about the game. Don't ask him about March. I don't know. Is March Madness still a thing? I don't know. You know, it's I don't know. I don't know. It's you know, that was picked up by the Spirit. Amen, somebody. See how that Spirit works? So I do not know. I don't know much about sports. In all fairness, it was because I did not really have a role model, a male figure in my life to teach me sports. I remember my first experience with sports. It wasn't good. They didn't prepare me that you're going to get hit. Nobody told me about being hit. They just get on the field. I just know I was the last one to be picked for the team. I did not know why. Everybody had a problem with picking me, but I was on the team. The problem was when I played football when I was a kid living in the ghetto in the projects, and if you from the hood, I know y'all know Dallas, Frisco, Prosper, Princeton, Lil M, Wiley. I know Lucas, all that kind of stuff. I know y'all had this problem. But in the hood, we didn't have manicured lawns in the hood. We had old tree stumps. Y'all ain't gonna talk back to me. We had rocky roads. Come on, talk back to me. We had clotheslines. You know, back in the day, you'd put your clothes out and let that good air dry your clothes. But listen, there were moments I had an encounter with the clothesline. Lord have mercy. That clothesline, it gets you right at the neck. You hit it, you on your back. Those are just the days that I come from. And because of this experience, it created a distaste for sports. I was no longer interested. The moment I had my first fall, I'm out. I'm done. This ain't for me. I'm called to business. This ain't what I want to do. I know God has not called me to do this. That was my first experience with sports. And I tried a couple of times. I remember back in the day we used to play kickball. You know, kickball was a big deal back. I don't know if they do that anymore, but kickball. We played hood kickball. Hood kickball is different. It's different. That ball hits you a little bit different in hood kickball. Hood, that's amen, somebody. So in doing these different sports, one of the things that I dreaded was falling. And I remember the babysitter's son, they called me Red. Don't use this later. Don't put it out. Well, it's out there now. That was my street name, Red, street name. I am a twin. I have a twin brother, and they called him Blackie, and I was Red. It was because when we were born, don't y'all look at, come on here, TT. You know, come on. Don't do me. Don't judge my name, TT. T-Boo, come on. Y'all, you know what your nickname is. Folk give you a name that they're most comfortable with. So my name was Red. But I remember him saying, Red, you don't know how to fall. Like, what is he talking? There's only one way to fall. So I fall enough to say this ain't what I want to do. Then I came to realize as I was preparing this message that the Lord dropped that back in my spirit. He says, I want you to recognize that just like you didn't know how to fall then, There are people in the room who don't know how to fall. There are people who are in the room who don't know how to fall, which then makes them afraid to live. This is why you spend 14 hours in prayer, because you're afraid to live. Y'all ain't gonna talk back to me. After you pray, go and do. That's why you don't want to leave the house. You're afraid. You're scared to live. You're scared to do what God's called you to do. This is why you're always at church. I know we love you. Keep coming to church. But there's a reason why there's an imbalance between your life and your relationship with the church, because you're afraid you're gonna fall. But I'm here to help you understand something today. Like they told me over 20, 30 years ago, there's a right way to fall. Okay, it's got quiet. I feel the religious tension in the room, because this is not what you've been told before. This goes against everything you've been taught. And I've been in church since I was 3 years old, and that ain't what they told me. I'm getting ready to help you today, because I believe that's the problem, is we got people trying to serve God afraid to fall. When the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I'm here to tell you today that God can handle any and every fall, past, present, future. Is there anybody that want to give God praise that he can handle your fall? Now, before you get religiously on pious on me, listen closely. This is what I need you to understand. If you're going to do anything significant for God, you must understand that falling is part of the journey. Can't say you want to play football and not get hit. Can't say you're going to get on a basketball team and not be fouled out. Is that where the fouls is, or is that football? Is this fouling? Okay, got it. Okay, amen. Just catching it by the Spirit. That's all. So you the fellas are saying, move it on, Pastor. It's okay. Don't worry about it. We got it. But you get the points. I was trying my best to do some research to get all the narratives together. They left my mind, so y'all just pray for me. But I'm trying to show you that just like they understand that falling and being hit is a part of the course, I need you to see in your spiritual journey with God, in your spiritual journey with Christ, your journey here in the earth, as long as you're in the earth, they're going to be seasons in your life where you fall. Let's go to John chapter 16, verse 33. Are y'all with me so far? John chapter 16, verse number 33. Look at what Jesus says. He says, I have said these things to you that in me you have peace. Somebody shout, I got peace in Jesus. Come on, say that one more time. In him I got peace. Come on, say it again. I got peace. You have no business not having the peace of God. Amen. So he says, in me, you will what? Have peace. He says, now notice that he says, in me, you're going to have peace. However, the dichotomy is in the world. You're going to have what? Tribulation, but take courage because I have overcome the world. You got to see the tension in the text, that in Jesus, Dr. D, I got peace, but in the world, I will have tribulation. Okay, I need you to catch it. You in Jesus, you got peace, but in the world, you're going to have tribulation. Did you catch that? The writer is helping us understand Jesus. As a matter of fact, is sharing with us the tension and the dichotomy of his 33 years of experience in the world. He says, I have learned, I got peace. You got peace because you're in me. But as long as you're out here in these streets, trouble is going to come. Am I helping somebody today? What Jesus is saying, just to get down to the point, if I can give you the PKV version, Jesus is saying that cuts, scratches, and bruises is going to happen as long as you're in this world. However, there is a way to minimize the damages so you avoid looking like what you came through. Lord, help me teach this thing today. Can you find somebody on your road and tell them you don't have to look like what you came through? Come on. As a matter of fact, you don't look like what you... Is there anybody in this room that want to give God some praise that I don't look like what I am coming through? I'm laid off, but I don't look like it. I'm behind on a few bills, but I don't look like it. I've gone through a divorce, but guess what? I'm happily married, and I don't look like it. Is there anybody in this room who would agree, I don't look like what I've been through and what I am currently going through? The concept of falling right or encountering setbacks without permanently being scarred by them begins, Brother Carlton, with a transformation in how we think. How we think. It's really about reshaping our default settings. Some of us have a default setting that when life hurts, you go back to that. Does that mean I can always tell when you got a new man? Because you have a default setting. Lord help me today. Boy, Lord have mercy. They say I'm holding all my birthday cash today. First service took care of me. So I can always tell everybody has a default setting. We have something we run to anesthetize pain. For some, it's weed. Amen. For some, it's rum and coke. Look at all my rum and coke people shifting. For some, it's tequila. All right. For some, it's overspending and shopping. Oh, got it. There we go. Bingo! We all have a default setting. But if you don't change your mind, you won't change your default. Which is why you can be saved and still doing the same things you did. The point of soul, Lord, help me today. See, when you sit in a house that instructs and teach, the objective is for the Holy Spirit to reset the default. Does this make sense? But if you never sit long enough for the settings to be reset, you will know a whole lot of scriptures while sitting at the bar taking them back. Because instead of running from pain, you will learn how to run to pain. See, when your default settings change, you understand that pain is not synonymous for sin. Pain is necessary for anointing. Pain, Lord help me today, pain is necessary for assignment. Pain is necessary because it was necessary that I was afflicted, that I may learn of your decrees. But if you don't change your mind, you'll take trauma personally. If you don't change your mind, you'll be a complainer instead of being grateful. If you don't change your mind, you'll complain about the rent house you're in while somebody else is under a bridge that's homeless because you want to be a homeowner. But if you don't change your mind and learn how to give thanks in everything, not just some. Let's just take a moment and pause for a second. I feel like there's somebody in the room that want to thank him. I feel like there's at least 100 of y'all in this room that want to thank the Lord. There's no way I wouldn't be who I am. I wouldn't be where I am. I wouldn't have what I have. Life is not perfect, but he's been God. Hallelujah. Can you find somebody and say life hasn't been perfect? But he's been God. Man, come on. I'll say that again. Life has not been perfect, but he's been God. He's been looking out for me. He's been in the clutch. He's been coming through. He's been a way maker. He's been a bridge over troubled water. He's, oh my God, I'm about to have a fit. Somebody just holler, he's been good. Y'all missed your moment. I'm going to say it one more time. Wait just a moment. I'm going to say it one more time. I'm going to give you just a quick second. Just somebody holler real quick. He's been good. He's been good. Oh, my God. Do you feel the relief? Do you feel the power of praise? Do you feel how praise can change a perspective? He's been good. All right. Woo! been good. Now, I don't deserve what I have. I don't deserve who's in my life. I don't deserve the favor. I don't deserve the money. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, it's been good. See, I know what your problem is. You don't recognize what you've been saved from. That's why you can sit there and act like God ain't been good. You won't recognize that somebody was in the first service on the front row, had just bought a brand new motorcycle, and in buying the brand new motorcycle, his first trip on his motorcycle was meant to kill him. And had a terrible accident and had to go right to the ER, but when they checked him out, no broken bones. See, that's God being good. See, I'm just trying to show you, he may not have been good in the way you think he should be good, but just because he's not good in the way you think he should be good don't mean he's not been good. That's all I'm trying to suggest to somebody. It's been good. Take your seat. So when we look in our letter this morning in Corinthians, we have the Apostle Paul. Somebody shout the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, who's also known as Saul. Some people preach that his name changed, when in reality, Mother Sherelle, his name did not change. Saul is his Jewish name. Paul is his Gentile name. Saul is his Jewish name. Paul is his Gentile name. His assignment required for him to be able to relate to where he was going. See, this is important because if you know that the thing that you've been called to then requires you to be familiar with where you're going. And so a lot of Paul's struggle had a lot to do with where he was going. Hence why he says, I became all things to all men that I may what? Win some. Paul says, I was willing to do whatever was necessary to win people to Jesus. So this man named Paul, also known as Saul. Saul is his Jewish name. Paul is his Gentile name. So anytime he was amongst the Gentiles, they talked to him as Paul. When he was with his Jewish brothers, which was his upbringing, he was known as Saul. Saul has an interesting past, and you can't really appreciate 2 Corinthians 10 till you understand the details of 2 Corinthians. Paul is writing because, number one, Paul is a little teed off. Paul is bothered by the fact that he has set up roots in an area that was doing everything but godly things. And Paul is struggling because there is a people who are playing mind games with the people he loved and have brought into the faith. Paul, if you know his past, somebody shout he had a past. He was killing Christians. He was killing Christians. And some scholars argue that Paul's past was interesting. He was killing Christians. Some, not sure if there's any truth to this, but I'll say it just for the sake of teaching. It is believed that Paul was a Christian killer. One, we must also appreciate the fact that there was a season when Paul was married. To be a part of the Sanhedrin Council, one had to be married to be a part of the Sanhedrin Council. Now, Paul had a marriage, he had a family, and he had kids. But he lived in Jerusalem, and in Jerusalem, earthquakes and natural disaster was just as normal as, what do we have here in Texas? Storms and tornadoes and things of that nature. Hailstorms is what I was thinking of. So Paul is in a time, this was before he entered into relationship with Jesus Christ. He had an entire family. It is believed that natural disaster caused his entire family to be killed. And so Paul has been trained scholarly never to blame God for anything. He's been trained to know skillfully that you ought not to speak negatively about God. So it is believed that part of Paul's motivation and issue with the Christians was since he could not get the God, he'd rather deal with the people. So some believe that his anger and rage for killing Christians was motivated, number one, by the fact that your God killed my family. This is why some believe that when he says there was given to me a thorn in my flesh, he says, and then I asked God to take it away. It's possible that he could have been grieving. It's possible that he could have been grieving, and this grief followed him regardless of how high he climbed in ministry as he did things for God. It's possible that Paul was still grieving. And every time Paul possibly went to God, he says, I went to God, asked God to remove it. And God says, not so, because my grace is sufficient for thee. In other words, you can still climb with your grief. I don't know who I'm talking to in this room, but there's somebody in this room I'm talking to right now. God told me to tell you, you can still climb with your grief. Oh, Lord, help me today. I don't know who it is for, but I sense there's somebody in this room that needs to hear. Maybe it's a grandmama. Maybe it was a grandpa. Maybe it was a mother, a father, your favorite auntie, uncle, whoever it was. But I came to tell you that God's grace is sufficient for you. You can climb even with the grief. Because this grief is the one thing that kept Paul coming back to God. Hallelujah. So as we turn to 2 Corinthians, we find not only a mentor who navigates his own challenges with grace and strength, but also we find in 2 Corinthians, he provides to us a roadmap, a blueprint. And Paul's experience with false perceptions and deceitful opposition becomes a mirror reflecting our own personal struggles. Now, to really understand 2 Corinthians, you got to grasp the weight of the context of the church at Corinth. The church of Corinth was messy. You think your last church was messy? Read 1st and 2nd Corinthians. It was a mess. Somebody shout, it was a mess. If you can't be a good member at Connect Church, shout, you definitely couldn't be a member at the Corinthian church. Amen. So it's just messy. Somebody shout, it's messy. It's full of drama, tons of challenges, relational struggles that Paul is dealing with. One of the issues is he's got some division that's taking place in the church. The church is splitting into sects and cliques. Some folk, I'm with Paul, another with Apollos. It's Christ divided now. He's dealing with folk naming and claiming their favorite preacher. He's got Elder Jerome ethical issues. There's a case of a young man sleeping with his stepmama. Yeah, that's in Corinth. Yeah. He's got believers suing each other. That's the church, the Holy Ghost church at Corinth. He's got foods that are now being sacrificed to idols. And so folk are losing literally their mind. And then you got the misuse of spiritual gifts. And so you got the gifted people who are arrogant, prideful, and confused. So Paul is dealing with a tough crowd. And because time is almost out and it's not my best friend, I got to move on. But the point that I'm making is the Corinthian church was a tough church. Corinthian was a melting pot of cultures. It's a melting pot of cultures, ideas, and not so many savoring practices as well. You'll find that they had Olympic-type games. You find that these games was drawing not only crowds, but it was pulling cash too. You find that there was a temple to the Aphrodite. And let's just say what went on in that temple would make a lot of folks blush. We're talking about 1,000 temple slaves caught up in a certain life. You just fill in the blanks, all right? And after establishing strong connections and a deep connection with witnessing significant conversion that has taken place in Corinth, Paul's departure has left a void that soon leads to doubt and deception. You find that Paul is technically on the run, and there are some accusations that Paul is on the run. And why is he running if he's an apostle? It is believed that one of the people that he led to Jesus Christ was his friend. He looked out for him and said, Doc, they're looking for you. They put a sheet together, put him in a basket. He escaped Corinth out of a basket, out of the window in a basket. And this created some, people don't know why you do what you do. So when they don't know why you do what you do, they create a narrative to try to stifle your integrity. That's all I'll say about that. So you got prominent leaders and figures like Crispus and Gaius and Estratus who have come under the faith, into the faith from Paul's ministry. But his absence became an issue and his absence became a backbone of this church that was growing. And so in the midst of this, folks started talking. They started saying that he wasn't a legit apostle. They started saying that he got his paperwork from Google, if Google was available at that time. They're saying that he's uneducated. They're saying that he has no weight to his name because, number one, he won't even let his own church take care of him. This is extremely important. It was equivalent to going to somebody's house and someone offering you something to eat and you say, I'm not hungry. That's an insult in certain cultures. Paul was rejecting the help from the church because other lazy leaders, y'all ain't saying nothing to me, started comparing Paul's ministry to the church. Paul became a tent maker. He was working with leather, and this began to really, really help benefit his ministry. But his work caused them to question who he really was because he was unusual. He wasn't like everybody else. He was not like the other preachers. And the concern is because Paul has established grassroots with this group of people in Corinth. Now he's got people coming behind his back trying to usurp his authority and sow seeds of doubt in the lives of people that Paul has led to Christ. This is where 2 Corinthians chapter 10 comes into play. And I want to look at this from the NLT translation of the Bible. Look at what he says. He says, now I, Paul, appeal to you with gentleness and kindness of Christ. He says, though I realize you think I am timid in person and only bold when I write from far away. They're basically saying that Paul was weak. He talked trash on paper. You know how folk talk a good game. You know, you get in an argument. You know my address. I'm waiting on you. I got grease and everybody, my friends. And then 3 minutes later, you caught in traffic. That's essentially what they were saying. Paul was talking noise, but didn't back his noise talk up. So he says, I know you think I'm a timid person and only bold when I write from far away. Verse 2, he says, well, I am begging you now. So when I come, I won't have to be bold with those who think we act from human motives. This is an amazing letter because it's a heartfelt letter, not merely a defense of his apostleship, because Paul could have dealt with the skeptics and Paul could have dealt and got them together. But instead, Paul uses this as a lesson for us concerning the mind games of the enemy. He gives us insight on how he can keep on task without being bothered by the comments. Lord, help me today. Your biggest challenge is you're so concerned about what other people think. You're so concerned about the comments after the post that you don't know how to be who God's called you to be. And you have to learn as a child of God, if you're going to deal with these habitual mind games, you got to be okay with what people say. You got to be, oh, Lord, help me teach this thing today. You're going to have to learn to take the applause. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me, along with the accusations. There's going to always be a group of people who's going to have something to say about your ministry. And if you're not doing anything, they wouldn't have to say anything anyway. So the mere fact that you're further than where they should be makes them intimidated by your ministry. And so Paul, instead of getting them together, he gives them somewhat a strategy. He gives them somewhat a blueprint on how to deal with mind games. Now I want you to understand that at the heart of every mind game is the manipulation of perception. Write that down. At the heart of every mind game is the manipulation of perception. Because the only way the enemy can get a hold of your mind is to change your perception. This is important. When someone is wrestling in their mind, their perception is off. When someone is wrestling in their mind, their perception is off. And their perception is focused on two areas. What people say or think about them, and then what you believe is true. So you're wrestling with their opinion and your internal opinion about yourself. And this is how you become double-minded. You solid today because you in church. We just had a great time. We praise the Lord. Everybody shouted, give God praise. But the question and the journey of your faith don't start on Sunday. It actually starts on Monday when nobody else is around you. And you got to manage the tension of what the enemy is saying in your mind. You got to manage the tension of the letters that are coming to you in the mail. You got to manage the tension of still working with the boss you know that don't like you and low-key is trying to cut you out of the promotion. You got to manage the tension of that because you care more about what people think of you than what God has said about you. Am I helping somebody today? So mind games start with the manipulation of perception. Guys, if I don't say nothing else, you need to hear me say that again. Mind games start with the manipulation of perception. It is your perception that becomes an area of opportunity where the enemy can start working overtime concerning how you see you. Look at what Paul says in chapter verse 3 of 2 Corinthians 10. Are we good? All right. He says, although we are humans in a body, an earth suit, you see that? We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons. It's so important because some of you are busy fighting family members when you need to be buying in the spirit. You're busy fighting people when you really need to be binding the spirit behind the person that's motivating the people you love. Lord, help me today. Oh, y'all could have a family reunion this year if just somebody steps up and be an intercessor. The family can come back together and sit around the table and have a good old time. But because you're fighting personality conflicts and because you're fighting people instead of going into prayer and engaging the enemy, because you need to know that the enemy always needs a host to frustrate who you are in God. And many times it's the people you give an access to you. Am I helping somebody today? He says, so we are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons. Somebody shout mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. Paul says, I could come and physically fight. I used to be a killer, but I'm not going to do that. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to do the polar opposite of what they think I should do. Yeah, I should come and give my resume about my Jewish upbringing and who I am in Christ and what I've come through. But Paul says, I'm not going to fight them the way they think I'm going to fight them. Paul says, what I'm going to do is I'm going to partner with the Spirit, and the Spirit is going to get them together, because you don't know God. God can get folk together better than you can get them together. That's why he says, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. So I need you to see that when you understand the nature of the battle in your mind is the first point of perception. It changes your landscape in how you address spiritual warfare. Paul gives us kind of attention. He says, we walk in the flesh, but we do not wage war in the flesh. Although we're human, we are bound by the limitations and experiences of our physical existence. But this acknowledgement is important for us to accept. But the crux of Paul's message, the real conflict, is one, you need to know that you're in war. You're in a war. So when you wake up every single day and you choose not to engage the spirit with who you are and what you've been called to do, you're basically saying, I'm going into this world in war unarmed. Okay. And this is why you're so quick to be tempted to get outside of character. The Bible says you must seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and what? All these things will be added unto you. God says, seek me first. He says, and then everything else will be added. But the problem is, the real conflict is, you are in a war. Somebody shout, I'm in a war. This war is not flesh and blood. It's spiritual, and it requires a different set of weapons. Am I helping somebody today? Write this down. Don't bring strategies of the flesh and think you're going to succeed in spiritual warfare. Do not bring strategies of the flesh and think you're going to win in spiritual warfare. Every single day. Somebody shout every single day. You and I are caught in a tug of war between two natures, the flesh and the spirit, and they operate from two different worlds because they are. The flesh wants what feels good now, solely focusing on itself, while the spirit on the other hand chases what honors God, that's driven by love and puts other people first. Here's what it gets tricky, though. Our thoughts can betray us. You can be literally in a moment of work. Anybody ever had to pray and spent time praying and a bill pops up? Am I the only one? First 5 minutes in prayer, I got to cast down every thought. Lord, in this moment, I want to be present in this moment. Lord, I just take a few moments and I clear my subconscious. I clear my mind because the enemy wants you to be harassed by commercials of what God is not doing, to prevent you from talking to the God about your circumstances and your situations. And this is why people run from prayer, because they're afraid of what's actually in their head. Have you ever slowed down long enough to listen to you talk? Right? And what the enemy wants to do is he wants your thoughts to continue to betray you. And they become the very chains that bind us if we don't anchor them in God's word, which is truth. Okay? So the question then is, where does these mental habits start? I need you to think of spiritual warfare as personalized. I need you to think of spiritual warfare as personalized. When the enemy wants to launch an attack against you, he's going to use what you like. He's not sending what you don't like. Okay, y'all quiet right there. He's creating a strategy that he knows will get you. And he's looking to find an opportunity where you're not strong in your walk with Christ, where you give in to the opportunity. Right? Just because you're saved does not stop temptation. Salvation does not mean there will no longer be any temptation. The scripture says that Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and after fasting and prayer, he was tempted. Which means usually the enemy comes at your highest spiritual moment. He usually comes when you're talking a good game to really see where you are. Am I helping somebody today? Go to Genesis chapter number 4. If you can give me 5 minutes on the clock, I'll close right here. Genesis chapter number 4. Praise the Lord. Genesis chapter number 4. In it you find these words. This is God talking to Cain. He says, if you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, look at this, sin is crouching at your door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. You see, God warning Cain, it wasn't just a heads up. It was a revelation of how the enemy works. And for Cain, it was jealousy. Him being jealous of his brother. There's a strategy the enemy is using and is usually embedded in your internal fears and doubts. So you got to ask yourself, what am I afraid of? What brings me intimidation? And whatever brings you intimidation is a thing that the enemy will use as a form of warfare against you. Oh, you're hearing what I'm saying to today? A bad parking spot is not warfare. It's bad timing. Them getting your order wrong is not warfare. It means you've had too much. You and your husband arguing is not warfare. It's called marriage. You being without money is not warfare. It's life. am I helping you today? You got to ask yourself, what are my internal fears and what intimidates me? And be honest, because this is between you and God. Because what's going to happen is whatever your internal fears and your intimidation is, that is the strategy, customized plan that Satan will use against you. And if you're not careful, you'll take it personal. Not understanding it's designed to get you off your game. And for Cain, it happened to be jealousy. His pride got in the way. And the enemy is looking for an opening. Look at your neighbor and say, he's looking for an opening. Come on, say it again. He's looking for an opening. He's looking for an opening to cast doubt on God's goodness. He's looking for an opening to undermine your faith, which is driven by obedience. He's looking for an opening to block the gospel's message with offense. You can be saved and offended. He's looking to muffle the truth through your daily choices. He's looking for an opening to belittle grace, pushing us towards bitterness and resentment towards our fellow Christian brothers and sisters. He's looking for an opening to fuel our desires. Watch this. With unchecked excess. Some of you all got too much. That's the problem. It is, you got too much. Oh, Jesus. Okay. You got too much and you don't know how to give away. You don't know how to let go. And so that becomes a strategy. And so greed is your problem. Lord, help me teach this today. Your problem is greed. Your problem is greed. Your problem is the fear of being that little boy who had to fight and you had to make syrup sandwiches. Or sugar toast. Y'all ain't talking back to me. I know North Dallas don't do that, but that was a day. But listen, that government butter, man, listen. Listen to me. You put that oven on 400 without trying to burn the house down because you know Big Mama would wear you out. But we don't, we it's our childhood traumas that have made us greedy. And that is the customized strategy that Satan will use against you. This week, I'm closing with a story. This week, my wife and I, now, if you know me, you know I spent my teenage years in and out of jail, just trauma and struggle, so quite naturally, I have this anxiety anytime I get around police officers, things of that nature. It just, because I spent my years running or being a kid that ran away from home, It's even me being in my 40s and have not encountered any police officers in over 20, 30 years, I still have that internal fear. And so for me, safety is important for my kids and my family. I don't want any of my children, thank God, they've never been to jail. They've never done anything criminally. I've trained them, praise God, in the way of the Lord. And my concern is my family. Well, this week, the enemy launched an attack against my family by allowing someone to call my wife and convince her that she had warrants for her arrest. The warrants was because she supposedly had signed a document to attend court to sit on a federal jury that was a serious case in the federal government, and because she missed her court date, that there were two warrants out for her arrest. This person called her. He kept her on the phone for about at least 30 minutes. She initially called and said, hey, got this call. What should I do? I said, call him back. See what it is about, etc. She gets on the phone. The person keeps her on the phone. And I said, babe, just click over. Merge me in onto the call. The person said, I'm sorry. You're not allowed to put anybody else on the phone because once we make contact, we can't let you off the phone. So she's on the phone, and I'm certain my wife, who's never been in any kind of trouble, the only trouble, she was on probation many, many years ago for ticket court. That's her street cred. She had to stop driving fast. I mean, just, you know, she really want to be down. She really want a story, but that's her story. I'm not taking your story. Preach your story, baby, all over Holland, International, London. Tell the people you was on probation. Amen. And the Lord brought you out. And so. See how people do your testimony, but people something else. So she's on the phone, and I know my wife, I'm certain she's in tears, and she's created this note, and this note, this person has created a citation. He's given her his name. I'm sure such and such, this is my badge number, da 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 da. She's on the phone, and she's texted me the address. He's given her the address of where the Collin County Jail is, and she is supposed to, in that moment, turn herself in to the public officers. I'm trying to figure out, I got my kid, my shoes on. I'm in the middle of sermon prep. No joke. I'm in the middle of sermon prep. My anxiety is through the roof. My wife ain't never been to jail a day in her life. She don't know anything about this life. You don't know. You know, so I got my tennis on. I'm mixed matched. I don't know where to go because he's holding her hostage on the phone. He will not let her get off the phone. She says, I'm afraid because if I hang up the phone, I'm going to immediately get pulled over. Matters are going to be worse. I got to go and I got to get a surety bond. And I'm like, wait a minute. I done been to jail. That ain't how that go. First of all, black folks ain't going to turn themselves in. First of all, that's just, we ain't willingly turning ourselves in. Amen. Somebody. Okay, y'all ain't going to talk back to me. Amen. So yeah, that ain't happening. Amen. Amen. She's such a good citizen. She's such a good citizen. So we finally figure it out. I call someone in this church who works for the Plano Police Department. I get him on the phone. I said, hey, I got a serious situation. I need to bring your attention. My wife is saying she's on the phone with this officer, da 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 da, and she has to turn herself in. I says, I don't know where she is, and I don't know what to do. She said, please text her and tell her she's being spoofed right now. She's being spoofed. He says, yeah. She says, yeah, we've been getting calls all day. There are people who are forcing people, manipulating people through fear, where they're going to withdraw money out of their accounts out of fear of going to jail. So she was on the phone with the person for JP over at least 30 minutes or so, and she was afraid, still going back and forth, and finally we got her to break free to hang up the phone call. We got on the phone. Here's what we had to do to settle her peace. We then called the sheriff's department. I said, I'm on the phone with my wife. She needs to believe that she has no current warrants for her address. So this is her name, her date of birth. This is where she lived. And the lady responds, no warrants. This they've been doing this for quite some time now. I'm sorry. Just be very careful of the phone calls you return. As a matter of fact, she says, if there was a warrant for your arrest, we wouldn't do it that way anyway. But here's the thing. Here's the trick. She don't go nowhere. What crime you committing? You don't go nowhere. And then I'm your chauffeur. So if we ever get pulled over, it's going to be because I'm driving. But it created a truth that I really believe that there was a sovereignty of God in that moment, because that I had to realize that there were still internal fears in me. Internal fears in my nervous system getting anxious and shutting down because of trauma. And so out of this lesson, as this we went through this and we laughed about it, we gave her a hard time, and she will never be able to live that down for the rest of our time together in life. It will be talked about at dinner tables, Christmas dinners, Thanksgiving dinner, anniversary days, all of that good stuff. Thank God for new content. But here is what I recognized, because as she was on the phone with a crook, there are those of you who are on the phone in your mind with a crook. And just because he knows more Bibles and can quote more scriptures than you can, you're holding on to the phone and not recognizing it's a lie. There are those of you in this room, you're in circumstances, you're in situations, you've done things that you're not proud of, and you think you have to tolerate this mess. You have to tolerate living beneath what God has done in your life. But I'm here to tell you, baby, you better snap out of it. You better recognize who God is in your life. Listen, I want you to know that when Jesus got on that cross, he had your past, your present, and your future sins in mind. He had your marriage in mind. He had your bad habits in mind. He had your isms in mind. He had your depression in mind. He had your oppression in mind. He had your come on, talk back to me. But here's the thing. If you don't know the truth, you will never be set free. If you don't know the truth. And so that's my first point, is you must know the truth. Look at your neighbor and say, you got to know the truth. What's interesting about the scammer is the scammer used somebody else's credentials. The scammer gave her a badge number. That badge number was designed to deceive her even more, to keep her on the phone even longer. Just like the enemy who masks lies with the veneer of truth. You got to see that our first step in spiritual warfare is to immerse ourselves in real truth, which is God's word. Somebody shout, I got to know the truth. Come on, say it again. I got to know the truth. And then secondly, what you're going to have to do, once you know it, you're going to have to state it. You got to state it. You got to state it. Somebody shout, it's not enough to just know the truth. You got to state the truth. My wife in that moment should have asserted the truth. I am a good citizen. I've not received anything in the mail. I've not signed any documents that suggested that I needed to be in court. And if I did, I would have been there today. But she was able to allow someone to harass her 30 minutes of her time that she'll never get back by information that was Googleable to place her in doubt and fear. The Bible says death and life is in what? The power of the tongue. So it's not enough to just know the truth. Beloved, what you're going to have to do is state the truth after knowing it. And once you know the truth, Marcinia, and you state the truth, here's the third thing. It's going to be liberating. Look at your name. It's going to be liberating. It's going to be free. It's going to be amazing. You ready for it? Hang up the phone. Hang up the phone. Some of you all came to church today for me to tell you to hang up the phone. There are people that's in your contact list. You need to hang up the phone. There are thoughts, there's ideologies, there's suggestions, there are pitfalls from people in your life. You just need to hang up the phone. And if you got an iPhone, I don't know if they do this on Android, but on the iPhone, you can block somebody. You can block them, boo. They can't even get access to you anymore. Why do you continue to give the enemy access to areas that God has delivered you in? Why do you continue to allow the enemy to placate your past? Which, when John the Revelator said on an isle called Patmos, when I was caught up in the thicket in the heavens, I saw the enemy making accusations against the people of God day and night. He says, but what was interesting, they overcame it by the blood of the Lamb and by the very words of their testimony. You need to know that's what I used to be, but this is who I am right now. So you got to know the truth. You got to state the truth and then just hang up the phone. This week, I'm telling you, is coming a phone call, a text, an email. Hang up the phone. Your peace is too critical for you to be engaging in something that you don't have to waste your time on anymore. You got to recognize it, who you are in God. And because this is a peace who will keep me in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. Stand to your feet all over this room. Can you look at your neighbor up and down your row and say, know the truth. State the truth. And hang up the phone. 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 Hang up. When you go, hang up. Stop tolerating it. Stop accepting it. Stop giving in to it. Stop giving it time. Stop trying to negotiate back and forth. Why are you going through this? No, listen. Listen, you need to know that if any man's in Christ, he is a new creature, and old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Don't entertain lies anymore. The Bible says that Satan is the father of lies, and in him there's no truth at all. Once you recognize that he cannot say anything that's true, as a matter of fact, every lie he suggests, you should flip it and recognize it's God's truth for your life. Am I helping somebody in this room? I want you to take your right hand, which is your authority hand, and I want you to take your hand and put it on your mind. Come on, put it on your mind. And say, Lord God, deliver me in my mind. Come on, but you got to believe that. Nobody has to lay hands on you. You're going to lay hands on yourself. Come on, say, Lord God, deliver me in my mind. Come on, say, I break every thought, every ideology, every mind binding spirit that keeps me from the knowledge of who I am in God. I break it now. Come on. Come on. Just say, I break it now. As you lay your hands on your mind, I break it now. Every thought of self-sabotage, every thought of insecurity, every thought of fear, every thought of low self-esteem, every thought of idolatry, witchcraft in the mind, double-mindedness. We break it now in the name of the Lord Jesus. I break it. Just say, I break it. I break it. I break it. I let it go. I let it go. I let it go. I let it go. I let it go in my mind. I let it go in the mind because I know God. Sin is conceived first in the mind. So I let it go now. God, as your people pray and believe you for deliverance, I pray, God, that you be the destroyer, that God, you would begin to destroy the yoke, that you would be the burden bearer in the name of the Lord Jesus. I thank you. Limitations in the mind are breaking right now. Limitations in the mind, limitations in their thinking, limitations in their thoughts. It breaks now. It breaks off of our young adults. It breaks off of our kids. It breaks off of our children. It breaks off right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. Deliver your people in the spirit of their mind now in the name of Jesus. If you believe you got deliverance, just lift your hands and worship for just a few moments. Come on. Come on, worship for just a few moments. Come on. Come on, just a few moments. Come on and worship.
Open now in the name of the Lord Jesus. I come. Come on, practice it, practice it, practice it. Because that's going to be your prayer request. That's going to be your petition this week. Come on, help us out. Come on, come on, let's say it together.
In the atmosphere, we need you to shift now. Every chain, break now. Break right now. Holy Spirit. Come on. Come on. Heaven open. Heaven is open.
All right. I need y'all to say it without any music. All right. Let's say it together without any music because I need you to know these words because you're about to enter into some environments this week that you're going to have to legislate it with the word of the Lord. You're going to have to legislate it with a prayer petition that decrees and brings the will of God in your life without any music. Come on, come on, come on. Let me hear you
and
say
the spirit.
Come on, let me hear you.
Shift now.
Shift now.
Chain be
chain
broken.
Be broke.
Break now.
Break. Yeah, yeah.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Come on down. Heaven's open.
Y'all got
heaven's
it.
Heaven's open.
Y'all got it.
Atmosphere.
All right, y'all drop out. Let me hear you. Come on.
Shift now.
Let me hear you.
Chain be broken.
That's it.
Break now.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit.
Woo.
Come down.
All right. Come heaven's on. Hold on.
Open.
Come, come, come. Come on.
Heaven's
come
open.
Come to the top. Come to the top.
And the sea shift now by the power of God. Chain be broken, break now. Holy, holy, holy Spirit, come on. Heaven is open. Heaven is open.
Oh, just worship, just worship, just worship.
We worship you, Jesus.
Thank you for giving us what we needed. We can run now, knowing that you've given us a race to run. So Lord, thank you that you've given us victory that comes through Jesus. And it is through Jesus we've got the victory. So Lord, I thank you that my mind has been adjusted. I thank you that God, my mind is going to be on your will. My mind is going to be on your plan. My mind is going to be on your agenda. And I pray, God, that as we prepare to go into this week, we're going to be ready now. We're going to mount up as wings as eagles. We are ready to run and not be weary. We're ready to walk and not faint. I thank you, oh God. This is the victory that we have in him, even our faith. Thank you, oh God, for the faith that's the title deed for what it is you called us to do. So Lord, I thank you that mind-binding spirits have been broken in this atmosphere. People have gotten delivered through your presence in the name of the Lord Jesus. Listen real quickly. I feel God in this moment. I feel the presence of the Lord. Wherever the presence of the Lord is, there is liberty. Somebody is in this room. They need to make a life-altering decision right now. And that is, you need to give your life to Jesus Christ. You need to give your life to Jesus Christ. If you're in this room, you say, Pastor Ken, I'm saved. I'm just disconnected. I'm away. You need to rededicate your life, recommit your life. There are people in this room that God says, it's time for another yes. It's time for a new yes. A new yes. Every day, God needs a yes. And I don't know if there's anybody in this room that want to walk uprightly before the Lord. I want to honor the Lord in everything that I do. And I'm willing to put myself out there and say, God, I've missed it in the past.
but I'm going to give you a brand new yes today. If you're in this room and you fit those two categories, it is, you don't know Jesus, and you want him to be the Lord and Savior of your life, you want to commit him to your life today, I want you to raise your hand. Or if you're in this room, you say, Pastor Ken, I want to give God a brand new yes. I want to recommit, totally dedicate my life to God in the name of Jesus. If that's you, I want you to slip your hand up. I want you to slip your hand up. I see you, I see you, I see you, I see you. You can put them down. You can put them down. Let's give God praise, amen, for decisions that have been made today. Here's what I want you to do. We're going to do it together. Look at your name and say, we're going to do this together. Say, Lord God, I am a sinner in need of saving. I believe in the finished work of your Son, Jesus Christ. I believe he died for my sins and he's raised from the grave. On today, I call him Lord and Savior in my life. In Jesus' name. God, forgive me. I've missed it, but today, my yes is brand new. I'm going to commit to this yes. Walk with me in Jesus' name. If you believe that prayer, put your hands together. Let's thank God. God, God. Hallelujah. Don't change on me. Don't change on me. Stay in the flow. Secondly, or thirdly, if you're in this room and you say, Pastor Ken, listen, I love God, I love Jesus, but I'm disconnected from church community. One of the areas of spiritual formation is, one, you got to get saved, but second is education. Education happens within a church community. It is not the will of God for you not to have a church home. However way you got here, someone could have invited you here, maybe Facebook's algorithm or Instagram or TikTok. I don't know how you got here, but the mere fact is you are here. You have now the job of trusting God's voice concerning you. And let me help you. You don't pick the church. God chooses the community for you. Let me say that again. You don't pick community. God chooses the community for you. Just like you didn't pick your mama and your daddy. But you're here. There are those of you in this room, you know the Lord is speaking to you right now. It's some about this place that you say, you know what, I can get with this. And let me help you. We're not perfect. We got issues. Just look around. Come on, look around, look around, look around. Look around, look around, look around. We all got issues. Here's what we're deciding to do, is to live better today than we did the day yesterday. That's all we're trying to do, is live better today than we did on yesterday. That's all we're trying to do. We're going to miss it. We might have a bad attitude, but we're working on our attitudes. Amen. We're working on it. But we would love the awesome opportunity to give you a moment to be a part of this community. No pressure, but I do believe you're supposed to be here. If you're in this room, I want you to get your belongings. I know we just met. I know this is our first day. And you're like, I don't commit so fast. It's okay. The day, the Bible says, the day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart. So if the Lord is speaking to you right now, and it ain't the fish you had the night before. It's not. It's the spirit. You ain't going to be able to get rid of it. That's why you keep showing up. That's why you stalked us on Facebook. Come on, you know you was checking us out on Facebook, on YouTube. All right. So if that's you, I want you to come right now. Meet me at this altar. We want to receive you and your family right now. If that's you, come. Leave your seat. Leave your seat. Is there one? One. There's two. There's three. Wow. Four. Five. Come on. Come on. Come on. Look at God. 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 One, two, three, four, five. That's five. We're not going to leave this incomplete. We know it's grace. But let's get to completion. There's at least two others in this room. The Lord's talking to you. The Lord's talking to you. There's at least two others in this room. You're in this room. Whether you're online, come on. Come on. I know what I hear. 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 When it doesn't happen in the service, it means that somebody didn't obey. Someone did not listen. Amen. Let somebody shout, there's grace. There's grace. There's grace. If you're watching online, just put, I'm coming home. If you're watching online, put, I'm coming home. If you're watching online, put, I'm coming home. But I know this is, wow, there it is right there.
Can we give God one more thunderous praise for adding to the church yet again? God continues to do it. God continues to do it. Listen, I want to say to you all, welcome home. We believe that we are the body of Jesus' disciples, where people from all walks of life can come discover God, find community, and embrace their purpose. I just want to pray for you, young lady. I pray strength over you right now. You've gone through a tough season. Man, I feel like it's been tough. It's as if you've been climbing all by yourself. You got here, you say, I'm going to just try it today. And God says, get ready, because now the burden is being lifted off of you right now in the name of Jesus. The burden is lifting off of you right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. We speak peace, peace, peace. We speak peace to your physical body. The enemy has tried. There's some internal sickness going on in your body right now, and it's due to stress. But I hear the name of the Lord saying, I'm healing in the name of the Lord Jesus. I speak to your physical elements. I speak to your organs. I speak to every area of your life, and I command it to be completed now. That God, you would complete the work concerning her, God. Because of this step of faith, God, you getting ready to blow her mind. You getting ready to blow her mind. That the struggling is coming to a sudden end, says the Lord. I hear the Lord saying, reprieve, reprieve. That's what I hear, reprieve, reprieve. A reprieve is coming where you're going to be able to enjoy the moment, because you're constantly going, work, 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 can't catch up, work, 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 work. But I hear the Lord saying, a reprieve is coming for you, woman of God. We speak strength. Can we give God praise? Oh! Hallelujah! Hallelujah. So we say thank you all. Welcome. Welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. Welcome. The trees, come on home, big girl. I see you. I see you. Listen, we love what God is doing in this great church. Come on, church family, can y'all come and greet your new church family? Come on, let's love on them. Leave your seat. Come, leave your seat. It's how we do it here. It's how we do it here.
And mercy, shift now. Change the world.
Christina is going to give you some additional information. Can we thank God once again as they follow her? Amen. Come on, come on. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. Amen. Listen, one additional thing, and then I'll turn it over to Pastor Billy. We want to take this moment to receive our gifts. Offerings, we know that it's the only way we get a chance to do ministry. It is us partnering with the church in which we have been called to serve in. Amen. We believe giving helps move the vision. Giving, somebody shout, giving helps move the vision. Amen. It helps move the vision. So we want to challenge you. We want to give you an opportunity to sow. If you're going to be tithing in this moment, lift your hand so we can celebrate God for you. Come on. If you're tithing in this moment, come on. Let's thank God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Bless God. It is where we commit 10% of our income
back to the Lord. Amen. We believe if the first part is holy, the entire lump is blessed. And so this is our opportunity. We don't tithe because we have to. We tithe because we get to. It is our response to what Christ has done for us on the cross. Amen. And so as you give, your support helps make vision possible. On next Sunday, it's going to be a tremendous, spectacular day. And we want you guys to help us by supporting what God has called us to do here through your tithe. Every other person, if you're not tithing, you can get an offering or generous amount of any amount, a generous amount in your hand. And let's stand and let's prepare our hearts to give. I want to pray over your gifts this morning, or afternoon rather. It's 1:26. Lord have mercy. It was a dance team. Then Pastor Billy got a little long-winded today, so. We all in trouble this week. It's okay. We'll be all right. Amen. Okay, you got your seeds in your hands. Slip your hand up. Let me pray over it. Father, we thank you for every gift sown in this moment. Thank you for your continued faithfulness. Thank you for provision in this house, Lord. Thank you that you've sent people who are generous givers, that they're sowing generously, not of just their time or their talent, but they're sowing of their resources. So, Lord, we know our ability to be who we are supposed to be in this city is through their giving. And so, Lord, I pray now that as they sow, God, that you would create better opportunities, Lord God, that this seed is going to be the source of someone getting to know Christ. This seed is going to be the source of someone receiving food. This is the seed that is going to be the source of someone receiving discipleship. And so, Lord, I pray that as you prepare their hearts, Lord, thank you that increase continues to find them, that we bring it back to your house. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say amen. There are persons in the altars or aisles that's ready to serve you. If you take your seat and send it left or right, amen. Whoever's there conveniently to serve you, amen. Praise God. I love you all. Pastor Billy.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. Better than that, can you celebrate him 45 years young? Hallelujah. He has been such an amazing blessing, not only to my life and the leaders here, but to every single person in here. For somebody to be so committed to the word of God, be committed to the people of God, it has blown my mind, and so I'm blessed to be connected. So if Apostle has blessed your life in any capacity, could you do me one favor? Stand on your feet and help me celebrate Apostle Ken Bennett. So we're going to ask that you help us be a blessing to our Apostle.
Yes, so you should have received communication on this week about how you can be a blessing to him. If you did not receive it, you can still participate because we want to be sure that we honor and appreciate.